For ages, men have gone down to the sea in ships. Hardy men who brave the perils of small boats and tossing waves to fish with hook and trawl, to fish with sweeping net, to bring back from the sea an important part of our food supply. While this monument stands watch over Gloucester Harbor, the descendants of centuries of fisherfolk there still carry on the glorious traditions of men who live by fishing.
Here's your coffee, John.
Looks like a fair day to get out to sea.
Seems as if you just got home. And in half an hour, you'll be aboard schooner again.
I'd better be. And off to the Banks. About all we got last trip was fog.
I know. And you can't sell fog at the pier in Gloucester.
Prices are way down, too.
Why don't you give up fishing?
What else can I do?
There are a lot of farms west of the Newburyport Turnpike. Some of them are for sale, cheap.
Yes, and why? It's because there's no money in farming, either. No, the sea's been good enough for us dailies for six generations.
Yes, the sea that swallows up our Gloucester fishermen year after year.
Now, you just keep cheerful. We'll hope for a big catch this trip and a better market.
And so, year after year, Daly and other Gloucester fishermen return again to the sea. Once aboard the schooner, no time is lost. The day is fair. Sails are quickly hoisted with a heave-ho to catch a favoring breeze. Every bit of canvas possible is crowded on as the schooner makes out to sea. To ensure quick passage, schooner sail is supplemented nowadays by auxiliary diesel engine power. Under full sail and motor power, the schooner heads toward the fishing banks, as nearby as George's off Cape Cod, or as far as the Grand Banks off Newfoundland. Routine sailing tasks occupy the time of the crew, or preliminary fishing chores, such as putting in shape dozens of tubs of fishing line, each with hundreds of hooks. Arrived at the banks, the crew chops small fish into bait for thousands of waiting hooks. Hooks are quickly baited and the lines of trawl cleverly wound into tubs. Without delay, dories, each with its crew of two, are loaded with lines and buoys and lowered over the side of the schooner. Each crew rows skillfully away some distance from the ship, perfectly at home in their tiny craft. Now they select a spot and toss out a buoy to mark the end of the line, and an anchor to keep it from drifting. A throw-out stick keeps fingers clear of hooks. One after another, the dories go over the side until the entire crew is at work. If the fishing is good, the long trawl lines almost at once begin yielding returns of cod, haddock, and sometimes halibut and other food fish. As soon as a catch is secured, the dorymen make the trip back to the schooner without delay. They toss the fish up on deck, where skilled hands clean and ice them or salt them down. Then off again to their lines, day after day, until the hold is full. Nowadays on the fishing banks, we find the steam trawler, a more modern type of fishing boat, and an even later development, the diesel-powered trawler, whose decks we shall visit for a time. Trawlers fish with large nets and reflect the modern trend toward machine operation, winches to control the nets, to lower or haul in, powerful engines to drag the nets along the sea floor. Below decks, the engineers carry out the captain's every order for control of fishing operations. Now at a signal, up comes one of the two great doors, which are fastened to the ends of the net to keep it open and near the bottom when dragging. Doors and net are hauled up by electrically driven winches. Wooden rollers attached to the bottom of the net keep it clear from a rocky, uneven ocean floor. The main part of the net is thrown back over as soon as the crew have looped a rope round the open end of the bag where the fish have collected. They haul this bag aboard. Then they loosen a ripcord at its bottom and the catch cascades down on deck. Part of the crew quickly tie the bag again and lower the net, while the rest go to work cleaning the catch. Here is a haddock, one of the more valuable food fish. And here, a cod, best known fish of the North Atlantic banks. Now the winches have let out 250 fathoms of cable, and the trawler drags the net again along the bottom. 4 knots an hour, while the cables strain mightily. Meanwhile, in his almost sacred galley, the ship's cook prepares solid fare for the hard-working crew. A watch of 5 crew members clean thousands of pounds of fish in an hour, clean them, and then fork them down into the hold of the trawler to be iced. Each kind is sorted here and iced in separate bins to save sorting at the market later. Here is a bin of large pollock. As the fish are cleaned, the oil man sorts out the valuable livers. Cod liver oil. Mealtime comes first to the men about to go on duty. Those coming off work eat next, and then have 6 hours to rest or to sleep in their quarters in the forecastle before their next watch begins. Day and night, this routine goes on. 6 hours on duty, 6 hours off. The nets come up every hour and a half, day and night, in fog or sunshine or in velvet darkness. The hold must be filled before the first fish caught begin to spoil. Fish market reports are the routine of the trawler's radio operator. A good market may mean a sudden end to fishing and a quick dash to port. Radio also brings help in case of a disabled ship or a crew member ill or injured. Night and day the net comes up under the watchful eye of captain or mate. When the end of the bag pops up far out from ship, it means a good haul. Winches strain under the load and the skipper barks his orders.
Follow back, boys. Follow back there. Pull her in. Follow back, boys. Pull her in.
Up comes the bag over the side, swollen with its thousands of pounds of cod, haddock, and other food fish, as well as scores of non-food fish. Oilskins come in handy for the man who has to dive under the dripping bag to loose the ripcord. Without loss of time, bag and net are lowered for another drag, and then cleaning and icing at top speed. Each deck bin is for a different size or kind of fish. Occasionally, the crew take time out to repair holes in the net, torn by hungry sharks or by dragging on rough bottom. Expert lace work and practical. In the wake of the ship, thousands of seabirds fight for bits of food washed from the cleaning bins. At last, the command comes to head the ship's prow homeward quickly to market. Decks are scrubbed and made ship-shape. The trawler plows at top speed for port, perhaps 200, possibly 500 miles away. On their way, the trawlermen overtake and pass the schooner, also headed for market. At last, after days and nights of tossing, the quiet of Boston Harbor, and that familiar goal of fishing, the Boston Fish Pier, through which more than 1,000,000 pounds of fish may pass in a single day. Our trawlermen, after one night at home, will return to the sea to carry on the traditions of men who live by fishing.